Thank you very much, Cindy. I really appreciate the opportunity to present to the group so that we can talk about the planning aspects of strategic sourcing. This is a great webinar, and the timing of the year that we get ready to focus on 2015, now is the time to do that strategic planning. And today we're really gonna focus on the process and how to put all this together. You know, your supply chain may not survive the next disaster. They recently did a survey of 400 CEOs of the retail industry, of which only 15% said that their supply chain could survive a disruption, a fire, a flood, a hurricane, a blizzard, and all of these we've seen this past year, and we can expect to see in the future. And when you only have 15% saying they could do it, survive, you have 85% that have presented an opportunity for us to show our skills and to take our supply chain to the next level. You know, we're also losing money in your supply chain. The same survey done by PricewaterhouseCoopers stated that only 17% of those CEOs have an optimized supply chain. You know, when we talk about an optimized supply chain, you know, your warehouse is working well, you're focused on the computer. Sometimes those computers don't work so well, and we get frustrated and just want to scream at the screen and say, enough's enough. And then sometimes we feel like a floor trader, as we see in the picture there, where just the vendors are coming up saying, buy my stuff, and you have to throw it out there to kind of say, okay, here's a contract over here, just because it's just running, on its own tactically and reactively versus strategically and proactively. Here's some recent examples in the news, and this is all current. You know, as of 2011, these were things that happened, as well as things that have happened recently as well. You know, the volcano in Greenland, when it's gone and it explodes, it shuts down the supply chain from here to Europe. You know, when we're doing the tsunami in Japan, the impact of all the parts that came from Japan impacted a lot of our automakers and other folks that are in the technology industry. Yeah, the retail, every year when we go into the retail and we're delivering packages for Christmas, you know, UPS is having these things, and they're experiencing delays because of strategic issues that could have been handled months before had a few folks gotten together to do some strategic planning by learning from the past, anticipating problems, and implementing steps to mitigate the impact of those issues currently. The overall point is, planning is essential for strategic sourcing and supply risk mitigation. We have to put the time in to do the planning. And when we say planning, it doesn't need to be complicated. We're talking about burning brain cells and electrons. A bunch of smart folks sitting in the room talking about the future and what do we need to do to accomplish the future state that we want to accomplish. Now, a little bit about me. As Cindy mentioned, I retired from the Marine Corps after 20 years of service. I enlisted back in 1989. Here you can see a picture of me and my brother in Okinawa. I met with Colin Powell when I was an embassy guard down in Santiago, Chile. And while I was there, I was accepted to an officer program where they sent me to school to get smart. And then I became an officer, where I was a platoon commander first, and then I became a supply officer. And at that moment, I decided supply chain was my life. Everything that I do is focused on supply chain management, developing and improving supply chain, because I just find it absolutely fascinating. Absolutely nothing happens in the Marine Corps or any organization without a well-run supply chain. You can see my wife, who I met in college. She's the smart one of the bunch, and my beautiful kids, they're all growing up. And that one picture in the middle is me on my last deployment, where I was a logistics officer for a combat logistics battalion, where we went overseas, and I was responsible for the global supply chain running from the United States to where we were operating overseas in many different locations overseas. And that's what a lot of my career towards the last 10 years was focused on, building and optimizing supply chains. And we would always start from scratch, where we had to plan it. We had to identify what our needs were, what our requirements were, do detailed planning down to the minute people would leave one location and move to the next location. Once they got to that location, exactly what they would do. As you can imagine, when you have a lot of stuff and people moving, it has to be well organized and well focused. And the mistakes you make in planning get exponentially felt when you start to execute. So planning is absolutely essential in making sure it works, and it works well. And the only way to do that is to make sure that we practice it and practice it. Here are three books I've published on Amazon.com. It talks about how to pass the CPSM exam, and you have a seminar coming up on September 18th. Definitely take advantage of that and get that certification under your belt. We're seeing folks benefiting from the long term in their employment, as well as the impact they're having on their organization based on the things they're learning in that certification. So take the time, invest in that opportunity, and make it happen for yourself. Supply chain analysis is a real quick, easy read. You can take a look at that. It talks about how do you analyze your supply chain. And then the supply chain management by the Marine Corps during Operation Iraqi Freedom. That's where we analyze the supply chain from Foxhole to the United States and everything that happened in between. And that would really demonstrate the things we're talking about today in regards to planning and how important it is to planning. There were some very big oopses in the Marine Corps planning process where there was a lack of communication, where one thing was decided on one coast and not executed on the other coast, and it had an impact on the actual operation. But Marines being Marines and people being people, they adapted, they overcame, and they still accomplished the mission. And that's what we do no matter what. So if you'd like to get the slides, you know, as we talked about last time, just text the word TEAM to 58885 and you'll have a copy of the slides in that presentation. If you have this before, we'll be adding these slides to that webpage. You can download all of this or just visit the website www.supplychainteamtraining.com and you can pull down the slides there as well. So what we're going to talk about this afternoon is what you must do before planning begins. It's planning is efficient when you have a lot of information before you actually start. So you want to know not only what you need to do before, but what factors are going to influence your plan. The management tools you need to execute. And at this point, I'll go ahead and say, it's not software, folks. It's not software. There's a lot of folks that throw software at a lot of problems, but the people that have to execute that software still find it cumbersome and complex. And then you take a very simple process, throw software on top of it, and make it very complicated. So consider these tools, just some things you can do that once you have proficient execution, then you can add automation. And then how do you communicate these sourcing plans to your larger organization? It's a process that you have to exercise. It's a process that basically tells you a series of steps that you have to take to accomplish and build your strategic sourcing plan. It's the steps. Step by step by step provides that structure you need to make sure you don't miss anything, that you don't overlook anything. It identifies your strengths and weaknesses because you have a bunch of smart folks like us in the room burning our brain cells trying to figure out the success of how we're going to make this stuff happen. We identify the strengths and we also look at the weaknesses honestly and we develop plans on how to mitigate those weaknesses. We identify how we're going to measure success, how we're going to know what success is. It's going to streamline your activities because you're going to have a well-exercised process. And that's what we're going to talk about is the actual process of planning, the things you have to do step by step by step. And the first time, it's going to be a challenge. It's going to be frustrating. But at the same time, at the end of it, it's going to be exhilarating because you're going to have a strategic plan that you can execute. You can always go back to that strategic plan and say, why are we doing this? What was that reason for doing those things? And we're going to give a very general process that you can follow and easily implicate or easily implement with your team, your strategic sourcing team at work. Okay, it all starts with a vision. Just as we see here in the picture, there's a person here creating a statue out of a chunk of stone. And they had a vision before they ever started. And then as they started to chip away, the vision they had started to become reality, as we can see here. It starts to become reality, something that they can actually execute. The vision is what we would consider your CEO's guidance. What the CEO and the board have agreed upon for your company, for your organization. Where are we going to be in 1 year, 3 years, 5 years? What does it take to get there? Knowing what that is, knowing what that vision is, it gives you a focus so you can focus your energy and your resources to accomplish that vision. And if things come up, as they always do, we can ask the question, does this help us accomplish our vision? And if the answer is no, we don't do them. Or we relook at our vision to determine if it's something we want to change. But you have that baseline to challenge the good idea factory, as I like to call it. You can combine it with your mission statement so everyone knows without a doubt where you're headed and what you're going to do. And what I'd like for you to think about right now, and go ahead and just write down on a piece of paper or type in your screen, not just on a scratch, what I would call a notepad that I have when I'm taking notes on a computer. You know, where do you want to take your organization in regards to supply management? What is the vision 3 years from now, and how would you see it operating, shifting from tactical transactions to strategic sourcing, where you're proactively managing based on data? You're implementing long-term solutions with your vendors, not just processing purchase orders overnight or at an urgent need that you have to execute. Think about that vision, scribble it down, and start to envision and feel how that's going to be 3 to 5 years from now to realize the value of this process. The next step is the mission. The mission really gives you even more intense focus in that, you know, it gives you the who, what, when, where, why. Why are you going to do this? It doesn't give you the how. The way we would use the mission is once we had commander's guidance or our CEO's guidance, and then we had our mission, is that people can execute and take initiative so long as what they're doing supports the mission. If they can justify what they're doing and why they're doing, is it going to help accomplish the mission, then it's a good decision. It's something you want to have happen. You don't want people always sitting back in the background just waiting to be told what to do, because that's a lot of wasted time and a lot of wasted energy just sitting back waiting. Instead, you want people proactively thinking, and you want to give them guidance and structure to bounce that thinking off, which starts with the vision and the mission. You know, it gives you everyone a focus. When we talked about building a procurement team in July, you know, that forming stage and that norming stage focuses on the mission, where people have a sense of purpose. They know why they're part of that team. It answers these questions: what business are we in? What customers do we see? Do we serve? Why does this organization actually exist? And just a quick story in why it's important to answer this question is, I was in a seminar, business development seminar, and there was a person that was asked this question, and he specifically said, well, I'm an eye doctor, I help people see. And they go like, well, we understand that. There's a lot of eye doctors out there, but what makes you special? It's like, well, I sell eyeglasses. It's like, okay. What kind of eyeglasses do you sell? Well, we sell all kinds. I said, okay, well, maybe you're not necessarily just a doctor that fixes eyes. Maybe you're actually in the fashion business. In other words, you provide eyewear that is fashionable, that people want to wear, so they wear their glasses. And once he understood that shift in his focus of not just helping people see, but actually providing them fashion, his business started to grow. His business started to focus on bringing in high-end glasses that were more profitable than just providing eye examinations and fixing folks' eyes, which is important. But as you know, there's lots of eye doctors out there, and how could he be special? And that was how he was able to shift. It helps everyone understand what's expected, and it helps focus your planning and your performance. And provides clarity and certainty during chaos. It's very interesting when you have a very clear mission, when things start to go crazy, when people start to lose control and situations happen, you can always fall back to your mission and say, what do I need to accomplish? And it really gives you a very clear focus on what to have happen. The process is, you start with defining your basic service. What business are you in? Who is your customer? For us in the supply chain world, our customer normally is our internal customers, providing our users with requirements that they need to serve our clients. So what is this purpose of us? What primary consumer? Who is our primary consumer? How do we provide that service? Do we just receive purchase orders? Is there a process of submitting purchase orders? Is there a budgeting process? What are all the processes involved in providing that services? And what are goals related to your mission that are going to help you be successful in this area? You should have basically 1 to 2 sentences answering who, what, when, where, and why. And I specifically call out, you don't want to tell people how to do it. Because when you tell them how to do it, they'll do exactly what you tell them, exactly what you tell them. But if you give them the freedom to execute and use their creativity, you'll be very surprised at how well your people perform for you once they understand your mission and where you're headed for the long term. And more than 1 or 2 sentences, then it's no longer really a mission. You start to get into that vision, and you want it to be very simple, something people can tell you right off in a moment's notice. Say, hey, what's our mission? And they can tell you exactly what it is. The next step, after you understand your vision and your mission, is understanding the factors that shape the situation, And this is what I would consider the second most critical part of the strategic planning process, and why it's the third. Once you understand your vision, where you're headed, the mission, where you're focused, then you have your influencing factors. These are the things that are going to either help you or stop you from accomplishing what you want to accomplish. You want to look at these things in a way that you reduce your friction. You want to make sure that it's anything that's going to affect your process, things that you can control, and understand things that you can't control. and you're going to look for things that you can actually see, touch, and feel. You will make assumptions, and you want to validate those assumptions. You want to make sure that's there. And it starts with your external factors. These are all the things that you can't control. You can't control. Instead, you want to make sure that you have identified these things, because they can throw your plan off base. Not just your plan in strategic supply management, but also your organization's plan. You know, economic factors, social factors, political factors, technology, things in the environment, things that are happening that we can focus on. Economics, the budget. What is your budget? Are you looking to capture more market share? When does your fiscal year end? What things do you need to do to spend all the money in your budget or not? Report those numbers up so you can get rewarded for your success as a strategic supply manager, where you're saving lots of money, generating lots of money and profit for your company. What shifts are happening in regards to social attitudes? What are people's opinions? What are people's perceptions of supply management in your organization? Is it a positive perception or is it a negative perception? And that will tell you how much influence you have as a strategic leader versus just a tactical person that processes paperwork on the other side. What political issues may affect you in your internal organization? You know, what's your CEO's understanding or your owner's understanding of supply management? Do they feel that's a strategic part of their business or just something that gets done over time? You know, what laws and regulations are changing? We have a midterm year election this year. What changes may happen in the political arena that may influence our success? Same thing, you know, in 2016, we have a shift of administration. It's going to change one way or the other, and it's going to be something different. What can we do today to implement things that will mitigate the impact of those changes in the future, or at least have predictability in our business cycle so that we can see it in the future? What technology things are shifting? We see a huge shift in technology in regards to cloud technology. There's very much talked about in business about getting things in the cloud, the software as a service, software as a service, the SaaS, and having that technology available, which enables us more as supply managers, but also there's more risk. So what things do we need to be doing to mitigate that risk and reliance on technology? Is there something we can do? What's going on in the environment? Looking at the environment, what laws are changing in the environment that may prevent us from getting things done or may enable us to accomplish more? It's really just asking all these questions in a way that helps you get a picture of what's going on. So think about this as one of the activities this afternoon. You know, go ahead and write down some things that are going to affect you specifically in your strategic sourcing area, your supply chain purchasing procurement area. Think about those things that affect you specifically. Then also think about things that not only affect you, but affect the broader organization, as well as the outside community of your company. So, you know, you kind of have a vision and an idea. So when you start to get into the goals, you can challenge those goals based on this situational understanding. And then talk about how you're going to mitigate or reduce the effect of these things. And then you always want to look internally. This is the tough conversation. This is where people don't want to ask the hard questions because they don't want to talk about the negative stuff. And the negative stuff is what we have to talk about. We have to identify those weaknesses so we can turn those weaknesses into strengths. You want to look at your resources. What tangible assets do you have? What facilities do you have? What materials are you using? What is your fiscal situation, your money situation? What are these things that you can actually touch and feel and you can use to help accomplish missions? What are your intangible assets? What's your reputation? What's the morale of your department? What is the experience of your department? What kind of skill sets don't you have that you need to get? And what things are you going to have to do to get those skill sets? What's your organizational capability? You may be working with a small company that doesn't have a lot of funding to build a big system. So you need some other kind of system that's not as expensive, but just as effective as a large system. And one way to do this is using the SWOT analysis: strengths, weaknesses, opportunities, and threats. Something very common to many management courses, and one of the things that we talk a lot about during the CPSM certification is the SWOT analysis. It's something that we talk about. Strengths and weaknesses are internal focus. Opportunities and threats are external focus. And just running through that scenario, asking yourself the tough questions and trying to find out what's going on. Look at your resources. What resources do you have to help you? Is there something in short supply that you need to start looking for other vendors to help you? Or is there plenty to go around and you don't need to worry about it? Instead, you should be negotiating better prices because there's plenty of suppliers, but not that many buyers. Who's in control of the resources? Take that supply chain two or three tiers back and go all the way to the raw materials that make up that material and understand that market. So when there's a shift in that market and you see it impact your pricing, and you can already take advantage of that before it impacts the pricing. In other words, you see a shift in oil prices and you are in the resin business, and that shift in oil prices goes up, you know eventually it's gonna filter down to you in the resin business. So you should be taking action to further to reduce that impact by either putting in a long-term contract with a vendor, working commodity strategies, many of the different things and different things that you have available to you by just thinking about them. And it's not difficult, it's just difficult thinking about it because of everything else you have going on out there. What resources do you have? Can you break up some resources? What are your processes? Looking at value chain. And there's two ways to focus on things. There's these process improvement, continuous improvement philosophies, Six Sigma, lean management, and value chain management. And value chain management is very similar to lean management, where lean's focused on eliminating waste. Value is focused on adding value to your customer experience. So just a little bit different question, but having a different impact based on the result. Instead, you're focused on adding value to the customer. Anything that doesn't add value is removed, but anything that does add value, you maintain. Maintaining those resources. Once you understand your external situation, you're gonna create your goals. These are the broader goals. The goals lead you to your action plans or your strategies, grand strategies on accomplishing those goals. But this is where you sit down and you think, okay, we're in strategic supply management, or we're gonna shift from tactical to strategic. And I went through this where we were shifting through and we were focusing based on building a strategic sourcing department that was very effective. And it started with shifting from tactical. First, we had people just buying whatever they wanted, not controlling their inventory, just having a good old time, and we were always looking for money and out of blowing our budgets left and right. Once we shifted to strategic, we implemented situations that repaired equipment instead of throwing it away. We had our own laundry that made it more responsive and cheaper for us to run versus always having to go out and buy it and do those things. We had our property disposal where we were able to benefit from selling that stuff versus just turning it in and throwing it away in the trash. Okay, so that's where we start to look at goals and shifting. And we want our goals to be in the near term, 3 to 12 months, and long term, 1 to 5 years. And some may say, well, why do you want to look out 3 to 5 years? We're never going to get there. Well, if you don't know where you're going, how are you going to get there? So think big, think challenges. Say 3 to 5 years from now, 5 years from now, we want to have strategic sourcing where we have an ERP system, where we're doing 3 to 5 year contracts, da, 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 da. And you want to think big in this area. And you want to make sure your goals are smart, specific, measurable, authorized, realistic, and timely. Another acronym, and of these five, the ones you want to definitely have identified is you want to make sure it's very specific, you want to make sure it's measurable so you know when you've achieved success, and you want to make sure it's timely, meaning it's time bound. So when you set up a goal, you're going to accomplish that goal in the next 3 months, the next 6 months. And so you have a date, and you can always challenge that date, and you can always move the date. You say, okay, we're going to accomplish this in 6 months. We're at 3 month mark and we haven't even worked on it yet. Okay, well, let's push that back. It's still important, but it's not important for the near term. So that's where we look at the timely, okay? And things you want to consider: cost savings, productivity, your employment development, getting into the CPSM certification courses, your employee relations with operations, sales, and marketing. How can you make those better so you get more information, better information? How is your relationship with your vendors and your customers? What technology might you need to implement to be more strategic? What's the public responsibility to work with you or not work with you? So think for a moment. Just brainstorm some ideas, throw down maybe one or two right now that you can think of goals that you want to implement for your strategic sourcing team. This is something that you can take back this afternoon or tomorrow morning or next week and after the holiday and say, you know, folks, we're going to take this to the next level. This is one goal I want to work on. And then we're going to talk about building some strategies on how to accomplish that here in a second. And not only do it for yourself, but get your team together and say, guys, if the business won the lottery and we had unlimited funding and unlimited resources, what would you want to accomplish? And find out what it is and then prioritize it, challenge it, make sure it's realistic, and throw it down, because this is going to become your roadmap for the next 12 months to 3 to 5 years. Okay, and then really drill down to the SMART and make sure they're very specific and measurable. Okay, same thing with the long-term objectives. We'll write those down. And once you have your objectives, you're going to implement grand strategies. This is how do we accomplish these things, the step-by-step for accomplishing things. And I wrote down an example of conducting research. I was working with a cost analysis, get authorization, get your funding, and go ahead and make your purchase. That's just an example, step by step by step. So the first step would be like conduct research. Well, how long are we going to conduct research? Who's responsible for conducting that research? When are they going to turn it in, and who do they have to report it to? And then we do the cost analysis, same thing. Who's going to do that cost analysis? What's going to be our baseline? What benchmarks are we going to use for our cost analysis? How are we going to receive authorization? Is this something that has to go up the chain to our CEOs, or is this something we can make a decision on our own? And then get the funding. Make sure it's in the budget process so you have the funding to get things done. It's always frustrating to have a great plan that is not resourced. You don't have the money, the people, the time, and you just sit there knowing it's a great idea and just can't get it done because you don't have the resources. So you want to make sure you do that. We were working on a project, and I was working with a team, and we had just an example of why I want to make sure it's resourced is we had a list of maybe 1,000 different tasks. So when we had those 1,000 tasks, my next step was to say, okay, let's go ahead and assign resources to those tasks, meaning people to those tasks. And within about an hour, I started getting phone calls back saying, hey, Randy, we need more people. I said, okay. And that was the whole purpose of that exercise, was to identify all these tasks, which were valid tasks. They had to get done, but also understanding that we were going to run out of resources and people, and that the remaining tasks that we didn't have people for, we were going to have to contract out to get those things done. But we had to do that. Okay. So what you want to do is draw out the process from beginning to end, step by step by step. Identify your key decision makers, people who can enable you and influence you. Identify your critical points in the process, meaning by certain dates you should have certain things done. By certain dates, certain money should have been spent or not spent, meaning you don't want to blow your budget too early. And really map it out. And I think of this particular, six steps here, identifying who your decision makers are and who your enablers and influencers are very critical for you accomplishing these long-term goals and objectives, because you want to make sure they're aligned with you. If they're not aligned with you, you want to take action to make sure that they are. Okay. So go ahead and, based on the goals that we talked about before, you wrote one or two down, brainstorm a strategy to accomplish it. Step by step by step, how are you going to accomplish that goal? Who's going to do it? When are they going to do it? What resources do they need to get there and do that and accomplish that goal for you? Not only what resources do they need, how are they going to get those resources? Is it simply as going down and grabbing it off a shelf and using it, or do you have to talk to somebody to get the money to get that resource released? What are those strategies? And then you want to use management tools. As I mentioned earlier, this isn't software, folks. There's a lot of software out there that can help you get things done. But if you don't know how to use the software, or you don't understand the purpose of the data you're getting from the software, it doesn't help you. You have to have good management tools to help you. And it's really just sitting down and thinking, how do I control things? Okay, we have four types of control. We have what they call premise control, strategic surveillance, special alert controls, and implementation controls. Now, premise control will be something like a day-to-day dashboard. How much are you spending? Where are we in regards to number of purchase orders open? When are we going to close that? Where are our parts in the supply chain? When are we going to receive them? Just basically day-to-day operational of a dashboard. And strategic surveillance is focused on accomplishing those strategic goals, using maybe a balanced scorecard. And I use the word maybe because, you know, there's lots of different tools out there. Based on your strategic goal, you're going to decide what tool is best for you. And that's what you want to make sure you do. And special alert controls are going to be things that you want notification when something's going to happen. If all of a sudden we are getting to 95% budget execution, that means we only got 5% and we got more time than money, then we need to have somebody tell us so we could take action to either reduce our cost or go get more money. And then when we talk about implementation controls, when we're implementing things, you know, certain milestones we want to achieve, and when we hit those milestones, make sure that they are going to achieve what you want to happen. But it needs to be event driven, not necessarily time driven. Okay. You want to set your standards, measure your performance, and identify any changes or variations from your standard. This is where your Six Sigma processes come into place. When you look at any process control philosophy, it always boils down to map it, measure it, analyze it, and improve it. And you have to map it and measure it, and you want to apply that measurement to a standard, and then based on that standard, analyze it, and then make an improvement. And that's where you initiate your corrective action. These are systems, folks. It's not software. Any system is just a process, a step-by-step process. It does not involve expensive software. It can help you, But if you don't understand the system behind it, it's not going to help you. It's just going to give you, it's just going to distract you. Okay. So take a look at the strategies we just talked about in the previous exercise. So when you can go back and look at the recording of this event and you go back and listen to it and you've got your strategies laid out, the next activity is to put in your controls. Determine what controls you're going to use to manage those activities to accomplish your goals. And that would be the next step. So this is the same process we do together when we do strategic planning. It's just step by step by step by step. And you exercise this process and it gets better. It gets faster. Your team gets better and faster. And it makes it more useful for you. And then what I want to do is communicate. There's many different ways to communicate. We talked before about identifying decision makers, enablers, and influencers. These are the folks you want to communicate with. They include not only your direct superiors, but also the people in the company, the investors, the local community, your vendors. You want to let them know about your strategic planning so they can be part of it and help you implement and be successful. I know one specific company, every year, they meet with their suppliers and they brief them on their strategic focus. Where are they going to be in 3 years? They meet with them specifically so those suppliers can start to take action to be there with them 5 years from now. Be there so that they can also be their vendors 3-5 years down the road. So they're communicating with all the right people so that they can be successful. So what are your next steps? I just want to highlight the supply chain opportunity that we started with in that, you know, there's 85% of CEOs, 83% of CEOs that don't understand the value that their supply chain can bring to their company. So you have a great opportunity in your profession and you want to take it to the next level and implement strategically the way we discussed this afternoon. You have companies not optimizing, you know, their supply chains, they just don't think about their supply chain at all, and their incentives are not tied to their supply chains. You want to make those changes and make those improvements, and it will justify the incentives. When you're saving millions of dollars, which goes right to the bottom line, that justifies an incentive, okay? And a lot of companies believe technology is the solution. It's like, well, we're just struggling with our supply chain. They come in and say, okay, we're going to have a brand new system and we're going to use it. It's like, okay, but then 3 years later, that one's not working, so they implement another one. And 3 years later, that one's not working, they implement another one. So you just change after change after change. Technology is there to help you. It's not the solution. It's a tool. You have to make sure that you understand the solution, where you're headed, and then you can use the tools to help you get there. Okay, the results of your success is going to be a 2.5% savings equals the same amount of profit as an increase of sales by 10%. And there was a discussion on LinkedIn in the CPM group talking about this specifically, where someone was asking, you know, how do you measure this ROI, justify these numbers? And someone was very good in breaking out the justification behind it, basically saying that when you sell something, say a $1 million contract, behind that $1 million is a lot of expenses. So that $1 million sale may only be a $250,000 profit when it's all done, or $25,000 profit, depending upon what's going on. But when you save money, when you save $250,000, that goes right to the bottom line. That's profit right there. So there's definite value there in what you're doing. And what you're seeing are companies are 73% more profitable when they manage their supply chain. These are, you know, statistics that still hold today. And you can imagine when you have 85% of CEOs not doing this, why this statistic still stands. And it's even better, you know. So the point here again is that you have a great opportunity. And you're a superstar. If you're on this call, if you're part of ISM, you are a professional and you want to go to the next level. You want to make sure that you recognize problems and you take action. You're going to link your strategies, not just with supply chain, but with the rest of your organization. You're going to talk to operations and marketing and sales. Get their input. Maybe involve them in your strategic planning so that you can align your efforts with their strategies. Monitor your progress. You know, ask the tough questions. Give management what they need to help you, which is what they need is information. And once they have information, they take action. Okay. And look at your resources and money, and then enhance your communication throughout the supply chain. And who's involved in the supply chain? Everyone. So the more they know, the better they're able to help you. Better they are able to help you. Okay. Make sure you have the correct strategy. These are the fundamentals of supply management, which is a correct strategy, a talented managers, effective metrics, having a broad, clear vision, and understanding your differences. Basically, you're going to replace your hunches and your feelings with numbers that validate what you're thinking, and then management can give you the support you need to be successful. And make sure you keep score. So as you save money, you need to tell folks. We as a profession, the personality of our profession is very much, we're a humble folk. We don't like to talk a lot about ourselves. And we need to get better about communicating the facts. And I say it just that way. You don't need to brag about your successes, but at the same time, you don't want to hide the value that you bring to the organization. You need to make sure that you're communicating and telling people when you're doing well. When you save the company 10%, which 10% then equals $1 million, you need to let people know that so they see the value of you. Why specifically? When we've been out teaching, heard of two separate incidences. One where a company was looking to outsource their purchasing department. They're going to completely outsource it to a third party and say, you manage my purchasing. They were going to basically release the purse strings to somebody else and let them take care of their purchasing. Another one where there was a recent election in a state where the new governor, as one of his political promises, was to eliminate the purchasing department. Now, the reason for that is because they didn't understand the value of what we brought to the table. And so that's one of the reasons we have to communicate this and make sure people know the value that we bring so we can continue to add that value. Find out what matters and align with what's important and help things happen by making sure people are focused with you and helping you be successful. Look at the desired result they're trying to achieve. In other words, we in strategic sourcing and supply management, we only exist because we serve others. So we need to understand what they're trying to achieve so we can support that. And make sure you align with those strategies, okay? And focus the change, and then you will accomplish the corporate goals. We're there to help enable that. When someone reaches back their hand and says, I need this, you say, I absolutely have it, and you put it right in their hand, and they move forward quickly. Make sure you learn the fundamentals. As I mentioned before, get CPSM certified. You have a local CPSM workshop coming up on September 18th. Take advantage of that. Don't worry about the travel. Of course, I would love for you to come see me, but you know, take advantage of this opportunity and get certified. At the same time, if you don't have time, the timing's not right, or you want to be someone else, or you know somebody that's going to be where we are, we have courses all over the United States. We're going to be in Boise, Alaska, and Charlotte in October, okay? And then we're going to have a 5-day master course in Orlando in October as well. So if you have some junior buyers that are still not sure of the supply chain stuff, this is a great course for them to come out and see that. And if you want to shift to strategic sourcing, we get together, I'd come out and visit with you, and we would go through this strategic planning process that you just saw. We would take you through it and facilitate that strategic planning so that while you're learning strategic planning, you're also having a strategic plan created for you and provided to you at the end of that 3 days so that you would have it and then begin to execute with that. Okay. So again, I appreciate this afternoon, the opportunity to chat with you about strategic planning. I think it's absolutely critical that you do that. The next step in regards to strategic planning is understanding forecasting and building forecast and getting those resources, because that even makes your planning even more effective, because you can see the future based on historical data, indexes, and all kinds of economic factors that are out there. Again, if you want the slides, please text the word TEAM to 5885 or visit www.supplychainteamtraining.com. Those slides will be posted by this afternoon. So you can have these, you can use these as a resource with your team and just walk them through the process. And as you do this process more, it will become more efficient, more effective, and quicker to help support your objectives for the long term.